Welcome to Full Prefrontal, the show that exposes the mysteries of executive functions. This show is a collection of conversations about the role of the prefrontal cortex, which impacts your focus, planning, problem solving, emotional balance, and independence. These conversations will introduce mental tools that will empower you to shift your mindset for a successful life. And now, here's your host, Sucheta Kamath.
All right. Welcome back to Full Prefrontal, where we are exposing the mysteries of executive function. I am here, as always, with our host, Sucheta Kamath. Good morning, my friend. Good to be with you, as always. So I guess I'll lead it off with this. Welcome to Holland.
Yes, thank you. And it's great to be with you, Todd. So in 1987, Emily Pearl Kingsley wrote a wonderful article, which I often recommend to parents. She titled it, Welcome to Holland. In that, she writes, and I'm going to quote here, when you are going to have a baby, it's like planning a fabulous vacation trip to Italy. You buy a bunch of guidebooks and make your wonderful plans and the Colosseum, the Michelangelo's David, the gondolas in Venice. You may learn some handy phrases in Italian. It's all very exciting. After months of eager anticipation, the day finally arrives. You pack your bags and off you go. Several hours later, the plane lands. The stewardess come in and says, welcome to Holland. And Holland, you say. What do you mean Holland? I signed up for Italy. I'm supposed to be in Italy. All my life, I have dreamed of going to Italy. But there's been a change in the flight plan. They have landed in Holland, and there you must stay. So many of us have landed in Holland in one way, one or more realms of life. Are we happy there? Have we found the sights to see is the real question. What do we make of it? Using executive function is how you solve problems of life. That too, in a meaningful way, so that it helps us stay on a path to purposeful life. These skills are put to test when we experience roadblocks or face adversities. In general, executive function kick in when life throws unexpected wrench. Hence, at the heart of finding meaning in these conditions of challenge is resiliency, which means bringing into focus the adaptive shift and flexible adjustment needed to do what it takes. Finally, success comes to those who stay hopeful while exercising agency. How exactly one goes about colloquially opening another door when the first one closes. You cannot understand executive function without observing its impact beyond the individual. Having been in this profession, one challenge that keeps surfacing again and again is the invisible nature of executive function disability and societal preconceived notions about how able people do what they do. Being quick, effortless, timely, and without struggle is how we expect able people to be. And today, I want to take the opportunity to demystify this myth. Emily Pearl Kingsley ended her article by saying, I quote, but if you spend your life mourning the fact that you didn't get to Italy, you may never be free to enjoy the very special, the very lovely thing about Holland. And that's what brings me to our wonderful guest, Dan Habib. Dan is a filmmaker at the University of New Hampshire Institute on Disability. He is the creator of award-winning documentary films, including Samuel, Who Cares About Kelsey, Mr. Connolly Has ALS, and many other films on disability-related topics. He has recently released his new documentary, Intelligent Lives, which examines our society's narrow perception of intelligence. The Intelligent Lives Project also contains four short films focusing on effective practices in transition for youth and disabilities from high school to higher education and employment. Dan has received the Champion of Human and Civil Rights Award from the National Education Association and the Justice for All Grassroots Award from the American Association of People with Disabilities. In 2014, Habib was appointed by President Obama to the President's Committee for People with Intellectual Disabilities. So we have Dan with us, so I'm so excited to have him.
Thank you so much for having me today. I'm looking forward to speaking with you.
So there are several reasons why you are on this show and on the topic of executive function, as I mentioned in my introduction, that truly I would like for you to play many roles or, you know, put on many hats. I have you here as a parent, a hero, and more as an inspiration to all. Life produces best melodies when real challenges invoke passion to flip the convention on its head. And that's what you did. Before we get into that, can you tell us a little bit about your own childhood? Did you witness disability as you were growing up? What was the worldview that you carried about abilities, inabilities, and disabilities?
Sure. Well, yes, that goes back a little while now to think back to that time. But I actually remember it quite clearly because when I was quite young, I grew up in New Jersey in the United States. And I was in I remember being in a preschool when I was about 4 or 5 years old. And there was actually a boy named Richard who had a headband around his head all the time. And it kind of set him apart because Richard was like the kid with the headband. He was different from everybody else. And I remember asking my mother one day, you know, why does Richard wear this headband, Mom? And she said, well, Richard's had some ear surgeries and he has to protect his ears from, dust and things getting into them. And that satisfied it. But to me, just the fact that Richard was seen as having this huge difference because of something so really small and simple really struck with me. And throughout my elementary school and middle and high school and right into college, disability was really not a part of my world. And that's even given that I went to a University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, that was very active in social justice movements and civil rights, but never did I hear disability rights becoming part of the equation. It was never part of the discussion. So it really wasn't until I started work as a photojournalist and I just happened to take on one of my very first documentary stories for the newspaper was on kids with disabilities being quote unquote mainstreamed into regular classes, that this whole idea of disability and inclusion really came into my radar.
So what did you see when this idea about mainstreaming, which just seems to be a desperate measure for everybody wants to see children mainstreamed, which is kind of their psychological assurance that everything is fine now. And what did you notice?
Right. Well, to be honest, I would say that not everyone wants to see kids with disabilities mainstreamed. Even to this day, I think there's still a lot of resistance to kids with a wide variety of disabilities being included. But during that time, I saw that the kids, including this one boy I was really kind of featuring named Todd, was extremely happy and engaged being in a regular classroom. And Todd was kind of like my own son, Samuel, who I'm sure we'll talk about, has cerebral palsy, was nonverbal, but was obviously very engaged in the class and in the content. And it's around that time that I started becoming aware of this notion called the least dangerous assumption. And the idea behind that is that the least dangerous assumption you can make about someone is that they're competent, particularly someone with a disability, because it's very easy to discount or write off people that don't communicate in a traditional or typical way, or don't, you know, walk in a typical way, or hear in a typical way, or speak in a typical way. Unfortunately, our society's stigma around disability is very deep, and people with those differences often get written off or excluded. And so I saw Todd being engaged, but I also saw the friendships he was making and what he was bringing into the classroom in terms of, you know, just the engagement that other students had with him. And as I've come to understand this issue more deeply, I've come to see the incredible value that students with disabilities in the regular classroom have, not just for themselves, but to their peers. And I'm sure we can talk more about that.
Yeah, I think you make this wonderful point about stigma, and I immediately associate that with fear. You know, whether they're valid or not, they're irrational fears about either noticing disability and associating with disability or fearing disability having an impact, a particularly adverse impact on self. And this is the protective mechanism that everybody wants to stay away from it. And also, I think less visible disabilities, which is where I operate a lot now that I specialize with executive function, which is the incompetence in people, which is then associated with if you're not looking disabled, but you're behaving incompetently, that means you must not care about life or you are not worthy to be considered equal. And so that kind of really hurts my feelings. But as well as I see that it takes a lot of effort to change people's mind. So what did you notice after your photojournalism experience that by talking about Todd and bringing that to light, did you notice that people were willing to change their mind or open their hearts?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's a great point you make. And I think it's often the adults that have the hardest time with it. I find in general, kids have no issue for the most part. They're very adaptable, especially if they've been from an early age exposed to the full range of diversity of disability. And it's just like with other realities of life, right? If you have a community that's very diverse ethnically, then people will be much more comfortable with a very diverse ethnic environment or socioeconomic environment. Same with gender, same with sexual orientation. You know, kids who are exposed to disability very early on, it's nothing to them. It's part of, or I wouldn't say it's nothing, but it's a very natural part of their surroundings. But it's often the adults, whether it's the teachers, that are fearing, I won't be able to reach this kid, or I won't know how to teach this kid, or I don't have training in special education, I can't do this. And in fact, we have found that some of the teachers that have absolutely no training in special education have been my sons and other you know, kids with disabilities, their best teachers, because they just, the ones that are just committed to finding a way to reach this child and learning more about how this child learns and what they need, what kind of supports they need to be successful and how their mind works. It's not about necessarily special education. It's just about education and trying to reach these kids. And the same with other parents. I think sometimes people are just fearful of the unknown. And particularly, as you said, students with more hidden disabilities, and I would even specifically say students with emotional and behavioral disabilities, that is probably the population that is the most feared, I would say, by teachers and students because of a lot of misconceptions. You think of an emotional behavioral disability and you think of aggression or challenging behavior or screaming, yelling. It's more often anxiety or depression or feelings that are more self-destructive than they are destructive towards anyone else. And again, those students deserve the same rights as a student with a physical disability to be alongside their peers in a regular classroom with the supports they need to be successful. And I found time and time again, my son's teachers and other teachers I've met, once they have the experience of having a diverse classroom of kids with disabilities with the right supports, right? With the right supports from physical therapists, occupational therapists, speech therapists, paraprofessionals, whoever it might be, and they can be successful, it's a tremendously rewarding moment in their teaching career.
Absolutely. You know, I grew up in India before I came to US, and one of the things that benefits that I feel I have gained is it was unveiling of disabilities. There was no specialized institutionalizing of people. They were all in the same community. You know, you will mm-hmm. see person and the handicap accessibility issues are still not sorted out in India. So, you know, people not being able to go places, but then you have five people who are helping a person go up and down the stairs because people are actually coming out of their apartments and helping people to get into rickshaws and things like that. And right. and I when I was growing up, my distant cousin actually fell and hit her head, and she developed speech impairment. And of course, she was labeled as being dumb and all her life. And she was excluded from, she was considered unwell, honestly, and socially, emotionally dangerous because she would laugh without a reason. She would cry without a reason. And now that right. what I know, it's called emotional lability. And in fact, my parents were wonderfully compassionate people, and they kind of made us, forced us to interact and forced us to be with them with a great smile. And that actually helped so much for me to have no fear, which is basically where I see a lot of people being stuck. And the second point I think you made, which is very powerful to me, that, you know, that the children have no problems as much as adults do.
Right.
This reminds me of a psychological experiment they did with two identical circles side by side. And one is surrounded by smaller circles and one is surrounded by larger circles. And when children are asked if the center circles, the middle circles are the same or different, it's adults who can't distinguish. But the children, adults are influenced by the outer circles. And they, based on the outer circle, if they're small, they call the one in the center surrounded by smaller circles to be large. And the children are unable to distinguish the two because they haven't developed the contextual referencing. And I love that experiment. I always start with that when I talk about demystifying your own, the myths that bind you or to preconceived ideas that operate, you know, or create invisible forces, which make you inflexible.
Yeah, well, and I think, you know, it's important, you're bringing in an interesting study, and it's important to think about and know about the research too. And there's tremendous research, 30 years in the United States, that show that students with disabilities who are included in regular education classes end up having better outcomes, whether it's post-secondary outcomes for college or employment, relationships, behavior, communication, across the board. Students who are included in regular education have better outcomes. So, of course, we want that, right? I mean, on every level, it makes sense to have better outcomes for students with disabilities. But they're also finding more and more that students without disabilities actually can benefit academically by having more diverse classrooms by disability. There was a great study by a researcher at Vanderbilt University, Eric Carter, who took groups of students that were working together, preparing for tests and studying material together. And he would take one group, and that was a very diverse group of students with and without disabilities. And then he'd compare that against a group that was very monolithic. It was just students without disabilities. And he did this again and again and again with multiple groups. And in each case, the students without disabilities who were working alongside their peers with disabilities scored better on the tests that they were preparing for. And so he was very fascinated by this. Like, why were students in this diverse group of with and without disabilities, why were they scoring higher on the tests, the students without disabilities? And he found that the students told him, we were more engaged in the curriculum. You know, we wanted to work alongside our peers. We ended up explaining it and thinking about it in multiple ways so that we could all understand. We were reteaching the material. And these students scored an average of 15 points higher on their tests. So I think it's important to know that the academic risks are negligible or non-existent to students without disabilities. And also the academic benefits are actually growing. And then you think about the social and emotional benefit, because it's not, school is just not about academics, right? I mean, that's important. But when we think about who we are as human beings right now in our lives, you know, not just what we do for work, but the movies we watch, the books we read, the friends we spend time with, the hobbies we take on, how much of that has to do with the academic experience of school versus the social and emotional experience of school? And I ask this of audiences a lot when I do public speaking, and every audience, 90-95% say the social and emotional experience of school had a bigger impact on who we are today as a person. And if you grow up in a school that is very diverse in every way, your social and emotional growth is exponentially greater. And so that's yet another reason I think why, you know, advocating for inclusive classrooms and schools is so important.
Yeah, and you bring up a very important point, which has become a wave, or at least there's so much awareness, the SEL curriculum, the social emotional learning curriculum. And it's interesting to me that now you have to go outside, or thinking that you have to now find more time or extra time to pay attention to child's wholesome development. And it's such a, it's a shame to me. Why are you thinking that as an outside thing? It should be, I mean, all the research in learning. In fact, one of the experts I had on my, you know, it's his name is William Clem, and he talks, he's a memory expert and learning expert. And he says that children tend to learn more when there's meaning, and that passion that teacher exhibits can come through and can really motivate the children. But I think once the motivated children, engaged children tend to retain what they're learning. And so you make such a good point about this, that the point of impact is not just shallow, or its radius is so wide. Now let's talk about Samuel. I mean, tell us a little bit about your personal journey, how all that came to a head when you had already done some work with children with disabilities and you were not expecting to experience what it will take to raise a child.
Right. I mean, the story I did that I mentioned earlier on mainstreaming was done back in 1991, and I didn't start having children with my wife until 1996. My first son, Isaiah, was a very typical child, actually always somewhat ahead of the curve. Always, he walked and said his first words, or took his first step and said his first words at about 10 months old. So if you know child development, that's quite young. To this day, he's a very good athlete and rock climber, and, you know, has, believe me, had his own significant executive functioning challenges, but not but not with any particular diagnosis, just boyhood is pretty much what it came down to. But he's doing wonderfully. He's graduated from college in May. And then we had our, thank you to him. Yeah, he's worked very hard for that. And then we had our second child, Samuel, in 1999. And it was just after a few months that we realized he was not developing in a typical way. You know, he was way behind in terms of trying to sit up and roll over and speak. And, you know, a long, long story that I condense here. But, you know, by the time he was about 1 year old, a lot of testing and assessments, we realized he had cerebral palsy. And that, if some of your listeners may or may not know, really what all that means is there's communication issues between your brain and your muscles. And it can be caused by many, many different things. It can be caused by birth injury. It can be caused by mitochondrial disorders, which is where more where Samuel's diagnosis lies. And so we quickly were thrust into this world of, wow, oh my gosh, you know, a lot of uncertainty, a lot of fear, a lot of grief, frankly, of losing the child, quote unquote, that we thought we would have in terms of two kids who were developing in a typical way. And suddenly you have to really adjust your whole life. As you said from the beginning, you know, you're in Holland instead of Italy. And so my wife thankfully did a year-long kind of intensive leadership series on disability rights and advocacy, and really understanding that people with disabilities can have these incredibly full and robust and amazing lives, and can be in regular schools and have great jobs and relationships and marriage and their own homes. And we, very early on, we realized that was possible. I did the same leadership series right after her. She said, Dan, you have to do this. You know, we have to be on the same page. So we did it. It was actually through my current employer, the Institute on Disability at the University of New Hampshire. And now Samuel's doing that series, by the way, at age 19.
Really?
Yeah. So
oh my goodness, that's fantastic.
So I, you know, there's no way to summarize, obviously, 19 years of life and experience briefly, but I will say that from a very early age, we realized that we wanted Samuel more than anything to feel like he belonged, you know, that he belonged in our home, in our community, in our extended family, in our, you know, city of Concord, New Hampshire, where we live. And we couldn't imagine him having that sense of belonging unless he felt like he belonged in his own school, right around the corner where all his friends went. So thankfully, we live in a community that is quite inclusive of kids with disabilities, but we've continued to advocate strongly, you know, for full inclusion. And And it wasn't until he was about 3 or 4 years old that I thought, well, maybe I'll do a film that shows this journey, you know, of inclusion. And I ended up spending about 3 years filming our life, Samuel's life, and the lives of four other families navigating life with a disability through education.
And thank you so much for doing that. Incredibly moving.
Thank you.
My sons and I watched over the weekend. I had watched it earlier. It was so moving. Thank you.
Oh, thanks. So that, I appreciate that. So that ended up becoming the film, as you know, including Samuel, which came out about 10 years ago. And that launched me into this whole new filmmaking career.
So did you know anything about cerebral palsy before you had Sam?
No, not as much as anybody on the street. Yeah, I just knew that it was a motor issue that ended up resulting in a lot of people having trouble walking, using wheelchairs, speaking, but I knew very, very little about cerebral palsy.
And as a parent, when you were trying to help him become more skilled, become better adjusted, and become more ready to handle the progression of life, what did you notice? What was so hard having cerebral palsy and achieve that?
Well, I mean, the physical demands on Samuel and on the family are significant. He uses a wheelchair. He uses a power wheelchair now. You know, basically the easiest way to say it is that he does everything all of us do. He just needs more help to get it done, you know, and in terms of the physical support, it's intense. I mean, you know, cerebral palsy is not the same for everybody. Obviously, there's some people that are very mildly affected by it. Some people are more significantly affected. You know, Samuel has a fair amount of ability to speak. Many people with cerebral palsy can't speak at all. Some speak very easily. It's a huge range. So I can only speak in our own case. You know, our own case, the biggest, I think, challenge is that it meant navigating the world of insurance coverage and durable medical equipment and speech therapy and physical therapy and occupational therapy. And he probably has 8 or 9 different medical specialists. And, you know, I mean, you talk to any family member of somebody with a significant disability, and we know, like, we understand each other. We understand that we spend literally hours, sometimes each day, certainly many hours each week, navigating things and logisticizing around things that nobody else has to worry about, no other parent has to worry about, in addition to all the things that you want to be thinking about, like participation in school and sports and friendship. But even simple things like Samuel now wants to go out on a date. And for a lot of kids, that means they go out in the car and, you know, they go out on a date. And, you know, it still has its own risks, of course. But, you know, for Samuel, it's a whole logistical question of, like, where can they go that's accessible? How's he going to get there? Who's going to bring him there? You know, how can he be with somebody but not have somebody right next to him the whole time? You know, how can you have that level of independence? There's just so many more things to think about and worry about. So I could go on and on, but I'll close that part with one really important comment, which is that I've asked Samuel many times since he was 7 or 8 years old, if you could get rid of your cerebral palsy, would you? And he has said no since he was very young. And it's because he now sees that as a part of his identity, and he's proud of that identity. He's proud of being a person with a disability.
That's incredible.
He's proud of being a person with cerebral palsy. He would get rid of all the medical interventions in a second, you know, if he could, all the blood draws and all the appointments we have to go through. But his own identity as a person with cerebral palsy is as inextricably linked to him as it would be to a Black person who if you said to them, don't you want to be white, or a gay person, that you said, don't you want to be straight? I mean, it's a part of their identity, and it's a part that they should be proud of.
And that's, to me, that goes back to that article I was talking about. You know, he has arrived in Holland and he's loving it.
Right.
He's loving the experience of it.
Holland is all he knows.
And he's okay with it.
Exactly. I mean, someday, you know, he may never get to Italy. He'll get to lots of other places. But if Italy is the place where you're not disabled, that's not a place he will ever visit.
So can you share with us some of the most interesting or surprising interactions you have had with people when dealing with you all as a family with a person with disability? I'm sure those are not most savory. Not all of them are most savory ones, but do you have something that strikes you as you would wish people have a better understanding, or somewhere you're surprised by people?
Yeah. Well, I mean, first, let me say there are many, many positive things that happen and have happened because of Samuel's disability. Sometimes it's just simple acts of kindness, you know, people going out of their way to hold a door open, or, you know, seeing Samuel waiting to meet his favorite NASCAR race car driver in heat and saying, you know what, why don't you go to the front of the line? It looks like this is hard for you, you know, or whatever it might be. Just simple things that are nice, that are kindness. You know, we appreciate that. And that happens again and again. There are certainly also some negative things. I think the biggest thing that bothers our whole family, and certainly bothers Samuel a lot, is when people talk to him like he's a 5-year-old. And that is a very common experience. If you ask anybody who uses a wheelchair, any adult, do people still talk to you like you're a little kid? I bet you'll get 99 out of 100 people will say yes. And it shows how what a stigma around disability exists, that people think just because you use a wheelchair, just because you speak differently or have a limp or don't see, you know, in a typical way, if you're blind or hearing impaired, I guarantee people will talk to you like you are a little kid, or they'll speak loudly or they'll speak slowly. And to me, that's the opposite of presuming competence. Right. I mean, what I was talking about earlier, the least dangerous assumption, meaning you assume someone's competent, that the idea is that you should presume competence. You meet somebody on the street who has a difference and you just speak to them like you would anybody else. And then you might learn that they may need certain accommodations in the way they communicate. And then you figure that out. But you start from a place of presuming competence. So I'd say that's the most common issue that we deal with and the most troubling.
How best have you redirected people?
Well, it depends on the situation. You know, my wife and I joke, we don't feel like being disability rights advocates every second of our lives. You know, so sometimes it depends on the situation. Sometimes you just blow it off and you don't make a big deal of it. Other times I will say to someone, you know, Sam will just graduate from high school and he's in college now, and just kind of wait and let them understand what they were doing. You know, they were speaking to him like a little kid. Or he actually has, you know, he uses a communication device for a lot of his language. He does have a button on it that says, you know, I'm 19 years old, right? Why are you talking to me like a 5-year-old?
Oh, that's great.
He doesn't like to use it very much because he's very non-confrontational, but it's there when he needs it. But so, you know, there are a variety of approaches. I think the most valuable thing is to just quickly let people know my son's in college. You know, yeah, that gives them a sense of, don't talk to him that way. Yeah.
That's actually, you just described, covered the whole issue about danger of low expectation, low expectations. And one of the things that I find, and simply like exposure is the key. Mm-hmm. I think people suffer from, not that they don't have that exposure, but they have not made that opportunity available to themselves. They haven't engaged. They haven't jumped in to find out more about the other person. And that to me is the highest form of closed-mindedness that I see.
Yeah. You know, there's a great expression. One of my early mentors is and was a man named Norman Kunz, K-U-N-C. He's an incredible disability rights advocate based in the Vancouver, Canada area. And he spoke to that leadership group that I did when I was young. And, you know, he was the one who said first to me, if you gave me a pill to cure my cerebral palsy, I wouldn't take it. This is who I am. It's a part of who I am. So that's, you know, again, how Samuel feels now. But he has a great expression he calls seek the story in the stranger. And the idea is that, you know, you see someone that is different than how you're used to interacting with someone, or somebody that doesn't, you don't quite understand where they're coming from, seek out their story, you know, talk to them, try and understand where they're coming from. What's their, what is it? And everybody has a story. Everyone has a story. And you need to be active in seeking that out and showing empathy and understanding and more than anything, listening, the ability to listen.
I just love that. Seek the story in the stranger. Mm. Beautiful.
Isn't it? Yeah.
And the thought that comes to mind, Dan, is this human beings are wired for storytelling, and we make connections through others through stories of each other. And I think if we just allow that to happen, I think there's a wonderful way to kind of find just human connection. And I don't see there needs to be any special like workshopping and seminaring to how do I connect to people with disabilities, you know? How do I connect with people who look different than me? I think get to know them, spend some time with them, don't be afraid of them.
But you need the opportunity to do that. And that's where I think society's systems of segregation are so troubling, because, you know, you don't understand what it's like to live with a disability, just as you don't understand what it's like to be of a different ethnicity or nationality or racial group than you are, or a different sexual orientation than you are, unless you have friends who have that diversity, or if you're in school alongside people with that diversity, or in the workplace or in community. And so that's why I'm so adamantly, you know, in favor of and working towards inclusive education, because I don't think you can truly understand that range of experience unless you are living it or living next to people and alongside people who experience it. Let me just say, it's why I love being a storyteller, as you just said, because short of living it, at least I can bring people into the lives of all these interesting people with disabilities and their families through film. And I think, you know, I'm hopeful that no matter how our society continues to evolve and change technologically and socially and politically, as you said, I think storytelling is going to remain. And I don't think that can be, for the most part, done by robots or done by automation. No. I think that real human beings need to continue to tell stories. And I just love the medium of film for that kind of immersive experience of bringing people into other people's lives.
You know, being a speech and language pathologist, I work with a range of communication disorders. And so ever since my kids were probably 6 or 8, they have come to my clinic, and I have done a lot of outings with people with autism or brain injury or stuttering or voice disorders. And one of the biggest suffering that came to a lot of these children was being ostracized for being different, different sounding, different looking, or just not being, looking odd, let's say. And one of the things I would encourage my children to say, like, just tell him, can you not do that? And they're like, no, mom, I can't tell him. I said, no, no normal peer is giving that feedback, but this is the reason he's not being included. But you are a safe person for you. You're the safest person they can be with who is lovingly going to tell them to stop. And so I had one young boy who was 12 who was obsessed with these giant roller coasters, and he would and he couldn't talk about anything but roller coasters. So my children, who also loved Disney, and we had been to many places where roller coasters were there, so they first had this encounter and didn't coach them, and they, this young man started talking about roller coasters, and my children were instructed to be very cooperative, playful, and engage, and and they, so they started talking about roller coasters, and then afterwards they started looking at me like, roller coaster or no roller coaster? And I'm like, no roller coaster. So they had to find the courage to say, no, can we talk about something I like?
Right. You know? But it's a, and I agree, it's a fine line though, because on one hand, you certainly want to have that give and take. And certainly people who might get fixated on something could benefit from learning how to turn their attention. But I also think that our society has very narrow definitions of what is normal and what is typical. You know, so let's say a person with autism does a lot of hand flapping, right? Which is a very common characteristic of someone with autism. Do you tell them to stop hand flapping? Or do you say, well, we just have to get used to your hand flapping because that's just part of who you are? You know, Samuel can often vocalize because he has trouble controlling his vocal cords because of the cerebral palsy. He sometimes has vocalizations during school that are not necessarily in keeping with the conversation, you know, but he's just, sounds are just coming out. The peers just get used to it, and they've gotten used to it. And I, we never hear complaints. We just hear that, you know, that's Samuel and that's just what he does. And so I think there's also that, you know, there's also this broadening the acceptable norms of what is acceptable and what is just a natural part of our diversity. So this is a complicated topic.
Yeah, no, and I often describe this to people that it's like Goldilocks effect. You know, it can be too big, it can be too small, it has to be just right, but that just right is contextually sensitive and it's individually and it's appropriate.
It's subjective and it's culturally subjective too. It's culturally, and if you think about disability as one of our, as a culture or autism or whatever it might be, you know, they have their own culture. You know, I'm not a person with autism, but people with autism have their own cultural norms and we should respect those, you know, and understand that just because they're not our norms, we are the dominant culture, like any dominant culture, we meaning people who don't have disabilities, the ideally the dominant culture becomes more accepting of minority cultures and more respectful of them.
Yeah. And I think the only point that I was trying to make, even with my, you know, my giving opportunity for these children with disabilities to interact with proto-normal kids, which is my kids, was only to give them an opportunity to give feedback, not to correct them and fix them, but understand that it is possible to receive feedback so that you can speak each other's language. Because that's when the communication gets completed, right? If I'm saying something and you never understand me, and if other person adjusts, but I never do, then there's meeting of the minds may not happen. And you, as you perfectly mentioned, that it doesn't need to be, I have to 100% speak your language, but I need to make effort to translate some of the words that I never understand what you mean by them. Right. But if I understand that's part of your repertoire, then I can say, oh, this means this to me.
Sure, and have that back and forth. Although I would push it back, I challenge you to think about one thing. You're using the word normal to describe your kids, which would suggest these other kids are not normal. And so I would, you know, so I think keep that in mind in your language.
Yes. And I apologize. You're absolutely right. What I mean, you know, what is neurotypical? Sorry, that's what.
Sure. Neurotypical is a good word.
Neurotypical is a better word than normal.
That's right. Exactly. Sorry. See what I mean about being, no, don't add it. It's part of the conversation, but it's this is what I mean about not, I don't want to do this every day, be the disability rights advocate, but it's also sometimes helpful to just point out things that all of us chat fall into. And listen, if I hadn't had this experience, if I wasn't working in the disability world full time, if I wasn't at the Institute on Disability, I wouldn't have that sensibility, you know, for all those.
You're right. And this is truly a slip of the tongue because this is such an important part of what I do every day, that who is making the most effort. And I feel as an advocate for children with and adults with disabilities, that if all the burden is put on those who are already dealing with the disadvantages created by their disability, we are being unfair. And so what burden are you willing to share? I do think that as we went back and forth about this, that the knowledge is to make allowances for this conversation to happen, to even see. It's like, to me, it's like you're coming to my house for dinner and I need to really take the time to understand what you would like to eat and not like to eat, you know?
Right.
And that conversation doesn't mean that I'm never going to cook what you don't like, or I only cook this so you eat what I have. But just that having that wonderful human negotiation to say, I would love to see you being part of my life, and this is what I'm willing to do. Is this helping you?
Right. And, and that's why I think that's why it's important, too, to look at the most marginalized groups in our culture, and in this case, disability, which is, you know, why my most recent project, Intelligent Lives, focused so much on people with intellectual disabilities, because statistically, people with intellectual disabilities are the most segregated group of people in the United States and internationally. I mean, in the U.S., only 17% of students with a label of intellectual disability are included in regular education, and only about 40% will graduate, and then only about 15% of adults with intellectual disability will be employed. And those are the worst statistical numbers of any subgroup of disability. So that's why I decided to look at this whole notion of how do we perceive intelligence, and how do we treat people with intellectual disabilities in school and life, and are there ways to shift that paradigm, to expand our perception of intelligence beyond things like IQ tests or SAT scores or any standardized tests, and look more broadly at how people can contribute to the world in very interesting and sophisticated and compelling ways that can't be measured by any numeric tests. And then who are the paradigm shifters? And that's when I ended up finding my three main subjects for my film, Mike and Nair and Naomi, and followed them for 3 years in order to make the film Intelligent Lives. So, you know, that's really what drove me to make this film, was thinking not Samuel's not the only one that deserves to be included. I really believe that all students, regardless of their disability, should have the chance to be included in regular school and in college and in employment.
You know, you bring this repeatedly, you're hitting on certain aspects of this process of coming to that place where a lovely human encountering can happen, which you said, changing minds, you know, looking at things broadly and shifting paradigm. Mm-hmm. And from the work of executive function that I do, one of the biggest challenges, there are two roadblocks in terms of one's own cognitive and social emotional abilities that comes in the way. And then there's a cultural roadblocks too. And that is the inability to shift mental set is a true, genuine cognitive limitation related to executive function. And second is attention, not being attention or not giving enough invested awareness-centric focus to other person tends to create roadblock in understanding needs of others, seeing the points of view of others, and really taking the onus on changing your own ways. And so I do that individual work. And then I see also societally certain, you know, like privileged lives tend to be less flexible. I'm not sure if you're aware of that the research. You know, they did this study where researchers literally stood at this traffic light and then the stop sign, I think, four-way stop sign. And they found that people driving expensive luxury cars tended to roll through the stop sign much more than people who drove less expensive cars. So there's a little bit arrogance associated with privilege. And I think this is a privilege of being neurotypical, that there's a little bit arrogance that you adjust to me rather than I adjust to you.
Right. And it's interesting you say that, because one of the three people I filmed, Micah Fialka-Feldman, who's a Syracuse University student, he's actually co-teaching classes up there. He's got a really wonderful circle of friends, graduate students, doctoral students, very full life, has a girlfriend. And he was given an IQ of 40 when he was a kid, which those of you who know IQ scores would be considered, you know, profoundly intellectually disabled. Anyway, he is one of the most kind of responsive, empathetic, socially adept people I've ever met. And so, as you say, it's like, what are we measuring here? And what are we valuing in society? If we have somebody that can be a wonderful friend, that can be caring and be with you and really tuned in, is there any reason that we should exclude them from any aspect of society or value their skills any less than any other skill?
And, you know, I think I've thought a lot about this. Why are we so unwilling to shift and accommodate. And I think primary reason is speed of processing. I think one of the things that people feel by associating with people with disability will be bringing on this slowness, which will create a disadvantage for me because things are not going to move fast. And I won't move fast in life. I won't go places. I won't reach the accolades or the whatever the invisible heights that I'm trying to achieve. You know, there's that fear, which is so sad because in fact, that's where the most beautiful thing is happening, which is the human, like you said, this most resilient and most kind and compassionate human being that you will ever see is happening right in that space.
Right, exactly. And you put your finger on something really interesting that I'm sure would take a lot of time that we may not have to discuss. But, you know, I think that we, again, some of this is cultural. I think certain cultures are more about speed, fast, go, go, go than other cultures. But I also think sometimes what we lose in all that is, what are we really living for? You know, are we living? And listen, I'm to blame as much as anyone. You know, I like to have very productive days. I work really hard. I like to move fast in my life. But I also sometimes just like to slow down and just be with my family or read a book or take a walk or just smell the fresh air. I just appreciate the moment. And that, you know, when people look back on their lives and say, what were your favorite parts of your life? It probably wasn't, you know, commuting to work or rushing to do this or speeding to do that. It was probably these really wonderful moments that you just had time to cherish your family, your friends, your relationships in your own time. And those of us in the world who can actually take time to do that can learn from each other. And I believe me, I need to learn that from a lot of other people. I have a lot of work to do in my own area in that realm.
You know, I have two young boys who are, I think, same age as your children. One is going to turn 21 pretty soon, and one is 23. And this Christmas, I gave them Pico Iyer's book, you know, Art of Stillness. And he says tongue in cheek that, you know, we take time to go on vacations or to these meditation and retreats, places to find a way to slow down, and then we come back to busy lives. But we have really reluctant to consider how about slowing down where we are. And, right. and that has been like a true mission. You know, a lot of my work, I have found that, you know, one of the ways to master your lack of, you know, being able to focus or distractibility or inability to shift your mental set or inability to remember all that requires time, and it requires you to give yourself that time, and that requires attention and awareness. We just don't have time. It's like driving on the highway at full speed because we are running late for an appointment with an empty tank. We are thinking, if I pull over to put gas, I'm going to be late. How foolish.
Exactly. And I think all my films, I have really tried hard to find people that I learn from and that I can learn from. And so, you know, when I did Including Samuel, I obviously learned from Samuel and all the people I filmed. I did a big film called Who Cares About Kelsey? And that was about a student with emotional behavioral disabilities talking about what it took for her to navigate high school and the people around her that helped her be successful. And then my most recent film I did, you know, Intelligent Lives, I also did four companion films just on people with disabilities transitioning from high school to college and career and how they all are using such innovative approaches to successful transition. And then another film I did last year was on national television here. It's called Mr. Connolly Has ALS. And it was a very profound experience for me because it was about Samuel's own high school principal who lost the ability to speak because of ALS and then transitioning to being a person with a disability. And then he and Samuel actually ended up starting to communicate with each other using their communication devices because they both used devices because they couldn't speak easily. And it was really a film, a very profound film for me to make and I think for people to watch because it was very much about what it means to be human and how perceptions of him, of Mr. Connolly, changed from other people once he lost his ability to speak. People started speaking to him differently, even though he was the same person inside. But also the great appreciation he started having for his students with disabilities because he could never understand what it truly meant to be disabled until he became a disabled person himself. I encourage your listeners, that film is free to watch on YouTube now. They just search Mr. Connolly, Connolly. Has ALS, or if you can put a link in your podcast. And also all the transition films I did as part of Intelligent Lives are free to watch online. So yeah.
I have watched three of your films, not the most recent one, which I will, but every film has made me cry. And I think though what is really touching about that is you have a wonderful way of showing humanity in me. I'm not talking about your subjects, but, you know, I think as I saw every main lead of your movie just reminded me how hard life is and I'm not doing enough. You know, I'm just thinking, in what ways can I affect life more positively, the way these individuals are affecting their own lives and making a difference. It's truly, genuinely a wonderful experience. And I highly encourage everybody to watch these films with your family members. If you are not as lucky as I am to work with individuals with disabilities so closely, this will bring you close. Dan, thank you so much for what you do and what you have done, telling your personal story, and most importantly, standing up for the rights of those who don't have the privilege to do so readily or easily. As we close our podcast, do you have anything else you would like to share with us?
No, I just appreciate the time so much. And we do have one site where people can go to kind of get links to all my films. It's just danhabibfilms.org. So just want to thank you very much and thank you for the work you do. Samuel's had many amazing speech therapists in his life who have done so much. And certainly in your work in executive functioning, it also rings very true to me for my older son. Samuel's executive functioning is amazing. He never forgets anything. But my older son, Isaiah, has needed some support in that area. And he is now finding his way and also finding his own strengths and tapping into those. It's a beautiful thing to behold. So thank you for having me today.
Absolutely. Great pleasure to have you and talk with you.
Thank you.
All right. It's all the time we have for today. On behalf of our host, Sucheta Kamath, today's guest, Dan Habib, and all of us at Cerebral Matters, thank you for tuning in and listening today. And we look forward to seeing you again right here next week on Full Prefrontal.
Thank you for listening to Full Prefrontal, exposing the mysteries of executive functions. To contact our host, Sucheta Kamath, and learn more about her work on improving executive functions, visit her website at CerebralMatters.com. That's CerebralMatters.com. Tune in next week for the next informative episode of Full Prefrontal.